Thank you, Dr. Rajneesh. I think this is the last session. May I invite my co-chairpersons, Dr. Sai Satish, Dr. Suman Bhandari, Dr. Rajiv Rajput is here, and Dr. Arun Mohanty. I think he's left. So this is going to be a very interesting session. Much before the night gets in, you start getting a feel of the so-called nightmares. That's it. Right now or later on? So there's some lucky draw, and we have to take out three out of them. So I'll request Dr. Rajiv Rajput to take out three of them. Dr. Parul. Now first is Dr. Parul. Is Dr. Parul around? Okay, so let it stay there. Second one is Dr. Rakesh Kumar from JNK. Bada dhoond-dhoond ke nikal rahe ho, koi apna banda hai kya? Now, this is Dr. VP Singh. He's from Meerut. So, best tarika hai, parchi daalo, ghar bhaag jao, usi ki niklegi. So that was on a lighter note. So we have to start the session, which is about the nightmares. I will invite Dr. Sanjeev Kathuria. He'll be presenting on retrieval of dislodged material. Dr. Sanjeev Kathuria is in the faculty of GB Pant Hospital for nearly 10 years, and he has a lot of experience in handling situations in which while you're working in the cath lab and you suddenly find that you lose control. You mean you have lost a control on your catheter, that means catheter is broken, or you have left your stent, or you are trying to deploy a device and suddenly you want to move the device in a direction, you find you are not able to move it, that means it is detached. So he will let us know as to what is to be done when he encounters a problem of dislodging a device material inside the intravascular compartment. Dr. Kathuria.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. We'll be going to start and listen to some device retrievals. So, first slide. I can't see here. Yani chal rahi. So once you have implanted a device and it has embolized, so already you have one harm has been done. So the important issue now will be to make sure that even if you're progressing and you're trying to retrieve the device, make sure that you don't do any further step which is wrong. So the important thing is that you have to keep your composure to make sure that you're doing a procedure in which you're keeping your cool, making sure that you're not creating any other further complication. So these are the types of snares, as you can see. This is a bioptome which catches the device. The difference in this is the wire in this kind of retrieval device, where you'll have more maneuverability. So that if you have to go into an artery or take a bend, because the device can go anywhere, you can catch the device. Now this is the most common snare which is used, the gooseneck snare, which has different sizes, so that you're able to, according to the size of the device which is embolized or area where you need to go, you can take the different sizes. Now this is an important type of snare. Again, see the difference between this snare and the gooseneck snare is that you have multiple holes, multiple loops. So you'll have more chance of catching a device if you're using this. Again, important thing is it has interlooped areas. So the catching property as well as the power of this is much more. If you're using a gooseneck, you'll have to make sure that you catch it and then you tie it very well if you have to stretch it and take it out. So this is an important thing in this. You have an intrinsic intercalated area so that they have a much more power of catching the device. Again, this is the angulated form, which is very good because let's say you have something which is lying on the side of the vessel and you need to reach there. The 15-degree bend helps you to turn towards the side where the the embolic material is lying. So I'll start with the first case. This was a 40 millimeter ASD. It anatomically looked divisible. Echo showed that the margins are there. There was a little flail superior margin, but rest of the margins were good. It was easily delivered. Wiggle was done. After delivery, it looked to be perfect on echo as well as fluoro. Another 2 minutes on the table itself, there were some VPCs, and the device became unstable, and the device slipped into the RA. There was a gooseneck snare which was used to catch but couldn't retrieve because of the large size of the device. The mullein sheath got severely kinked. So we took the delivery cable back from the mullein sheath, screwed it, and brought it back. So this is the echo. You can see there is a little deficient superior margin. Rest of the margins were good. So this is the wiggle. The 40 millimeter device has been delivered, and you can see that it's a fairly good wiggle which has been done. Now this is the device being released. This is the device being released. Not running. Till anyway, I'll do that. So post delivery, not running. There were some ectopics which are noted, and you can see that the device floated into the RA. It's not running.
So till the time he's trying to get his videos running, how many of you are in the business of closing the holes with devices? Kindly raise your hands. So quite a good number of them. And has anybody had any experience of embolizing a device? So we have as many hands over there who are doing these cases. So that means it's not an uncommon thing. If you are closing the holes with devices, then dislodgement is not a very uncommon thing, and it is in fact a very, very troubling thing, because and whenever you want to put a device, there is always at the back of your mind, in case the device embolizes, then what to do.
So this was okay. A good wiggle done. At the same time, echo is being done, which showed that the device is in good position.
So how many of you feel that this device is possibly going to embolize with that kind of a wiggle? Previous one?
The wiggle has been done.
Previous one? Done. Just show the wiggle, previous one.
Yeah.
And what makes you feel that this device will embolize?
See, it's a very good wiggle.
Now see that?
Yeah, you can see this. The LA disc is not moving.
No, the superior part of the LA, you know, I think it's not well approximated into the.
No, that is because of the wiggle. And now you see this is sitting well.
I think fluoroscopically it is very well tucked in.
Any other fellow who feels that this device will embolize with such a good wiggle? Dr. Manish, with this kind of a wiggle, do you think this device is more likely to embolize or more likely to stay there?
Giving a proper save. Yeah, this one. Same thing. I want to repeat what he was saying, sir, that the lower that margin on the LA side seems not good.
So you're talking about the lower margin, and everybody feels lower margin or the upper margin?
I mean to say this margin, sir, on the
which
LA
margin?
Side.
Lower margin? No. LA disc is fine. You feel that the LA disc is likely to get detached.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is it the lower margin with which you're not happy or the upper margin?
I think this one, sir.
So the moment
towards the vertebra. The
so the moment you answer that, that means you're not very sure. What about you?
Yeah, something is wrong with the LA.
Okay, so he feels that something is wrong. Okay.
See, I think the wiggle is the important thing to see. You can't
in fact, this is much more vigorous wiggle, and the recommendation is not to go for it. And this case is about 15 years ago, which was done. And at that time, the operator used to be rather cautious, used to do a lot of wiggle, because he used to feel happy if the wiggle is there. This device looks to be okay positioned, and with that kind of a wiggle, if the device is not getting into the LA, I think that was giving sort of a happy position that maybe it, you can leave it. Okay, now next
and
one.
I think it's most important to see is that the LA disc should not move on echo. I don't really think so. On a fluoroscopy, you can see the movement of the LA disc.
Okay, doesn't matter. Go ahead with the next one. Next one.
So this is 1 minute into the procedure.
Now with this device, how many of you feel that this device is possibly going to embolize? So what is your reason which makes you feel that the device might embolize?
It's not in alignment with the atrium.
No,
atrial
no,
septum.
No. The alignment is very good.
What's the view that this is 30, 35, 35?
What you can see is
there's
something abnormal activity in the...
Which part is? I think this is properly aligned. Properly. Absolutely there is nothing wrong as far as alignment is concerned. But what is wrong?
Is there something which is happening, something in the heart?
Okay, go ahead.
Breaking the moment.
Show the next one.
So now can you see something happening in the atria? Some ectopic activity in the atria? So that is what the ectopics make the sides where you have implanted a 40 millimeter device. Little relaxation aside because of the
See, if you have frequent atrial extrasystoles, and atrial septum is a part of the extrasystoles. And as some part, and extrasystoles might start from some area. So if the extrasystoles are starting from an area which is not giving a lot of support and it starts contracting out of pace, then this can lose the support. And if it loses the support, your device can slip. So if you have frequent atrial extrasystoles, once you deploy a device, one should watch out because frequent extrasystoles may be harbinger for a device dislodgement. Go ahead.
Now this is what happens. So it is on the table itself within 3 minutes, the device is in RA.
Now what next?
So the first thing we did was we took a biopterm. The important thing in retrieval of devices is one, two important things. One is that the area from where you release the device, the pin from where the RA side, should be the facing side because there you can catch the device. It is the larger part. And the second thing is device should preferably be at a position which is aligned to some structure so that you can hold the device from that end. And the structure, because you want to go use a snare should reach that point, and that structure should give you support so that the device doesn't move much. So this is a biopterm. So as to make sure that you're able to catch the device and stabilize it to a position. And here.
So first of all, this is a very, very unfavorable position. If your device is in RA, you don't have too many structures there to fiddle around. And you're also in straight line with the IVC. So you can catch it with more ease and with less discomfort to the ventricle. But if the device is in the ventricle, now what is happening is, one is that you are surrounded by a lot of trabeculations. Second is, often if the device is in the ventricle is irritated, you get frequent ventricle extrasystoles, and in fact it may be something like an ill-sustained ventricle tachycardia, and you will have often a significant hemodynamic compromise. So it's not a very happy position to catch a device once the device is in the ventricle.
So we are able to catch it from the RA side, and we're trying to get the 40-minute device into the sheath. Now that is a little challenge because releasing it is easier because you're going to pull the sheath to release it. But getting a 40-minute device into the sheath is
now
a
same device through same sheath through which the device is delivered. If you want to take the device back in the same sheath, it will not come. Because very often, you will not be able to slenderize and you will not be able to align the pin with the sheath. So that is what happened in this case. But what is happening to your videos? Okay.
Shall we discuss? You know, most of the times when you do the interatrial septal closure, atrial ectopics are very common. So do you mean to say that if there are atrial ectopics are there, it's an ominous sign?
Post deployment of device,
yes.
If you start getting frequent atrial extrasystoles, it is a harbinger for your device being unstable and getting out. Dr. Kathuria, your time is going out. You're left with 22 seconds. Your device is still in. We have to get it out.
So the first step was that we took a snare to the biaptome to catch hold of it. The next step was we tried our level best to get it into a sheath.
So anybody has any bright idea? If your device is not coming within the sheath, what could have been better? Well, the device went through a 14 French sheath. It's a large device, 40 millimeters. It went through a 14 French sheath, but it is refusing to come back in the same sheath. See, the biggest problem is at the entry point. The entry 14 French hole, if you do it, if you load it from outside, it goes. But if you want to load it inside with an angulated pin, it refuses to come in. Very simple technique which I do is, you just cut a bevel in the sheath. By beveling, kindly show the bevel, please. You see that the device is not coming in. And in fact, on pulling, the device is brought down into the IVC.
But still stuck up at the margin. So next, what has happened, the sheath has also got kinked. The sheath is also kinked. So now it will be very difficult to get this device into the sheath. So what we have done is we have taken the loader itself. And we have preloaded the device, pinned the device with the snare holding the device. We have pinned the device back into the loader.
So you tried to screw in the device inside only?
And then brought it back through the sheath. And back from the 14 of sheath.
So once you pin it, this becomes straight. It's easy to get inside the sheath.
Now see the difference, why I'm showing this slide is a little
if
different.
If you look at the right lower,
this one.
This you cut a bevel. If you cut a bevel, then the hole becomes bigger.
So
if the hole is only at the end, it's smaller in size. But if you cut a bevel, it becomes receptacle, becomes bigger. Now your device can very easily. So if you find that you are getting a problem in getting a pin in and you don't want to take a much bigger sheath, the simplest thing is let the sheath size be same, let the end hole become bigger and just cut a hole, cut a bevel. Once you cut a bevel, become big. Once the tip gets in, then things are easy.
You mean to say you want to cut it transversely or you want to cut it just
No, this is
slanter.
Kalam kaatte hain jaise ki beveling, kalam.
See that diagram is there. Like so we were working
if you
on
see
this.
That, see the diagram there.
This one.
That one?
Yeah.
I have another one. So this is the next case. This is the kind of sheath you should have taken. So if you've cut the sheath, you've increased your area of retrieving the device into the sheath. So this was another case. This time the device had embolized into the RV. Once again, stabilized with the biaptome. And this time with the biaptome holding on to the device, you've taken another sheath and trying to get the device into the sheath with the biaptome holding it.
Actually, this might look very, very silly as to what one is doing, catching both the ends. Mm. See, best way to catch the device is first stabilize the device. Because if the device is in the right ventricle and the patient is unstable, your rhythm is also unstable. So best thing is you catch it with the biaptome. Because biaptome can catch the device from any place. You can catch from the pin, from the wire, anywhere. Once you catch the device and make a little pull on it, your ventricular ectopy will stop. Because now the device is not free. Once your device is stable, now you catch the device from the pin side. But common mistake which people do is, once you have snared from the pin side, now you release the biaptome. So if you release the biaptome, and you have now caught it with the snare, and you are trying to take in a sheath, it is possible that you just slip the snare. If the snare is slipped, again the device will fly off. So keep the biaptome hold until the snare part is gone in the sheath. Only after the device is gone, within the sheath, then you release the snare. Don't release this early. So that is a message from this case.
Now this was a PDA device which got embolized into the RV. Same step, first the biaptome was taken and we took the device back into the IVC. From there again it was a little difficult to get the device into the sheath because the angle of the device was not good. So with the biaptome holding it there, we took the sheath, held it from the angle, the pulmonary and angle from where you release it, and then brought it into the sheath.
So it is a mechanical couple. one end or one side caught with the biopterm, the other side catches the pin with the help of a snare and takes the device in, and leave the biopterm or biopsy forceps only after large part of the device has entered the sheath.
This was a PDA device which got embolized into aorta. So again, the important favorable thing in this is that the holding, the part which from where you release was up. So you are able to go from the PDA back and hold it from that end itself. Took it and snared it to the end of the PDA and deployed the same device there itself to pulling it back better.
So that was about a decade ago. Mm-hmm. You have the deployer and the retriever both here.
And after that, this is a VSD device, 16 millimeter muscular VSD, which got embolized into the RPA. This was very easily retrieved, maybe I think in just 5-10 minutes, and a 20 millimeter device was.
Actually, the point in this patient is just go back. So often you should retrieve the device from the screw side, not from the pin side. Screw side is towards the venous side and pin is on the arterial side. Now if you look at it, this device is lying horizontal and the top is the pin and bottom is the screw. So ideally you should cut from the bottom side. Go ahead.
Caught it from the screw side.
Now what you find is that the device was caught from the, not from the screw side, but from the pin side. See, that screw is on the top. So a small device, especially if the sheath is big, you can possibly catch it from anywhere, it can get in. But if it is a large device and the sheath is also not very large, then you will have to catch it from the pin side only.
Importantly, because this was in RPA, so you didn't require a biopterm to stabilize it, because it was with the size of the device and the RPA itself, it was stabilized with the two borders up. And then we deployed a 20 millimeter VSD device in the same go. So if you don't have a snare on table, then what you can do is you can use the check flow wire. Take a check flow wire, bend its two end and put it through the introducer, and you can make a snare itself. For areas which are really accessible nearby, you can make a snare. Or you can take a Goulard Lubin catheter. It has two holes. So from one hole you can put a wire, you can bend the wire and put it in the other hole and you can make a snare itself. Important thing, once you make a snare, make sure that you bend it a little bit, because it'll do two things. One, your area of accessibility increases. Second, you are able to take the bends which are required if you are making a snare in the table. So important thing is device embolization, the causes are undersizing and improper deployment. You should always do a gentle wiggle, though you see in the first case we did a stronger wiggle.
Dr. Kathiria, and I think we have already taken enough time.
And only important thing is will be retrieval devices, you will have a nitinol gooseneck snares, which are very easily usable, and they have no sharp edges, so they can be put into any intravascular space. So these are the ones which are most commonly used. Most important is the additional technique. If you have lost a device, you should manipulate it by a wire, pigtail catheter, to get into more favorable position so that you can catch it.
I think you can stop now. Yeah. Any question from the audience? So if there's none, we thank Dr. Kathuria and invite Dr. Alok Singh for the next presentation. Thank you. Yeah.
Take this.
First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Rajneesh for giving me this opportunity. This was a case, 42-year-old male with the history of sudden onset severe chest pain two days back, with no known risk factor, and there is no family history of even hypertension and diabetes. And ECG shows the T-wave inversion lead 2-3 and AVF, and regional wall motion abnormality of the RCA territory. And I took the patient for NGO. It was a Sheppard-Crook type of RCA with approximately 99% dystenosis after three bends, one of the most tortuous region. And then I took for the intervention. Initially, I took the JR. I also kept in the mind it will not give the support. It was a very difficult wiring for me because there was angulation, 90 degree bend. Then ultimately I took for the AL2. It gives the proper support. And then I was able to do wiring with very much difficulty. I have used AL2 only 2 to 3 times only in last 8 years. And I was able to wire, and I was not able to keep wire in the main PLV. So because lesion was very tight and there were 3 angles, and I pre-dilated with the balloon 2:10, there was some slow flow and some sort of dissection. But I pre-dilated. Then I took the Endeavor Resolute 2.7524 across the lesion. And as soon as I deployed the stent, patient complaining of severe chest pain, and pressure started begin to drop. Then I took the views, and in the mean process, I have not seen the AL have jumped in. And I took the RAO view. It was looking like a spiral dissection to me. And patient was in severe pain. So I was not sure what exactly happened, but as AL2 was known to cause a dissection, so I thought some slow flow was distal to the lesion previous to the stenting, but I was not sure. So I took the 3:30 Endeavor Resolute, and I was thinking in mind, if I will seal from the proximal side, then I will put the another stent. You can see wire is coming out and guide is buckling. So, and patient was in severe pain and was in hypotension. And then I post dilated with the same balloon because I was fearing there might be difficulty in pushing the another balloon. So I post dilated with the same balloon. And after stenting the proximal segment, I was confident I have sealed the proximal segment. So if any dissection have occurred because of AL, then that have been well taken care. Then I took the another view, and dissection is persisted in the distal part. So I planned for one more distal stent to cover that. So I covered that portion as well. So it was a final result, and I have seen, and patient hemodynamics start improving. Patient started complaining of pain have improved, and hemodynamics have maintained. And I was the patient on table for 15 minutes. So patient hemodynamics was better, and artery was flowing. So patient, I shifted the patient, and I keep the patient in CCU for 3 days. I have fear in the mind. Patient might have stent thrombosis. And patient was asymptomatic for last 5 months after the procedure. Procedure was done in September 2017. And patient have again the recurrence of chest pain. And I was closely following the patient. And there was transient ST depression in V2 to V6. So first I took the RCS art. And it came to, I feel good because the RC was flowing. It was in February. To my surprise, when I took the LAD shot, which was clean in the first time, it was another dissected segment at the origin of diagonal and LAD. And I put the wire in both and pre-dilated. Then stented, there was nothing much in this time. 2 overlap stent I have done because there was a haziness in the distal part of the LAD. And this was the final result. So to conclude, it appears to me it may be a case of a spontaneous coronary artery dissection because there was no risk factor. I will like to have the comment of sir.
Well, at least if you look at the first angiogram, especially the right coronary angiogram, there is nothing to suggest that this is any type of SCAD because SCAD is of three types and it doesn't fit into any of the SCADs. However, the behavior of the right coronary artery and also subsequent behavior of the left coronary artery, it definitely tells you that this patient had the foramen frustae of SCADs, and these SCADs were which artery which can spontaneously dissect will often dissect with any intervention. So, and both of them, they can happen together. Means somebody who has a tendency to get SCAD is not immune to get atherosclerosis, and also somebody who has got atherosclerosis is not immune to get SCAD. Nevertheless, I think the only single teaching message which I will take home from this case is that, fine, everything was okay. But the things went wrong because in the right coronary, once we got a problem, it is always better not to keep shooting injections. If you keep shooting injections, that's a time that a vessel which is vulnerable, which gets dissected very easily, that dissection will also spread very easily. That's what happened in that case. So in such cases, if you want to take the shoots, your guide should be out, your injection should be gentle, and sometime you can take distal injections. Like if you have a wire already there, then you can take a twin lumen or double lumen catheter, which can be used for injecting. Or you can take a microcatheter on another wire and you can inject with the help of a microcatheter deep inside the artery rather than injecting through the guiding catheter. Because many times you can prevent further complications. Further complication means small dissection with multiple injections spreads all over. And see, you had a lot of difficulty in putting a wire in the PLB. But in between, once the problem occurred, your wire ultimately went into the PLB. So if you had the luxury of having a wire deep in the PLB, probably your procedure would have been more smooth. Dr. Rajput, please.
I think before Doctor. You stented, first stent in RCA, the dissection was there. It was extending into the PD. It was very visible. So rather than getting panicky with chest discomfort, obviously, you know, that's the best judge. Operator is the best judge at that point of time. But you should have tried another wire into the PLB at that point of time. Or you should have started with the end extent of the dissection. So in the end, you have managed it pretty well.
Because dissection plane was seen just above the around proximal edge of the stent. And because patient was passing in my mind, if my dissection had started in the proximal RCA. So I wanted to ensure from the proximal RCA.
That is perfectly okay, but the more vigorous shoots you take, more spread of injection dissection is there. So I think my understanding is that if you get into a trouble like this, feel rich, take more stents, start stenting from distal, and then come proximally.
I think there was the wire dissection distal started distal.
Yeah, distal.
And it was because of the wire position. If you in one shot you see. The wire was badly coiled.
It was wire induced dissection.
And because of the bend, I tried very time, but it was not going in PLB. It was very difficult wiring for me.
Which wire it was? Somebody asked
me. What was the wire?
Whisper.
Whisper? That is not whisper. Is there whisper?
I have tried with multiple wire, but finally I completed the case with the whisper. In case LAD, I tried with the whisper, but whisper does not.
No, we are talking about the right coronary artery. What was the initial wire? Because the terminal tip of the wire doesn't look to be whisper wire.
BMW.
BMW, it's fine.
Earlier I tried with the BMW, but final case done.
So nice case. I think it had some messages. I think we should give him a big hand. He's been able to present. And also one very important thing which is shown is that on follow-up, if you leave a vessel which is flowing, and if there is something like TIMI-3 minus flow, then more often these vessels will keep flowing. It is only if you have a significantly reduced flow, then these vessels tend to close. So may I now invite Dr. Harpreet Gilotra. Is Dr. Harpreet around?
Yes,
please. Dr. Gilotra wants to keep distance from us.
Sir, my slides could not be loaded on that.
Okay.
I'm sorry, can please help me?
Any question till that time, till such time the slides are loaded? No, I think this right coronary artery was huge in size. It is compared to the guide catheter size. This proximal RC is very large in size. Despite the fact guide dived in twice, the guide probably didn't do anything. Yeah. Because guide catheter dissection should start higher up.
A very good evening to all of you. So in my case, I just want to show a little carelessness can cost you sometimes very dear. So this was a case of primary angioplasty. I thought it's a very simple case. RCA, 60-70% proximal stenosis. My job was only to fix LAD, the balloon dilatation of LAD. And this was a stent placement. After stent placement, now either there's a snowplow effect or my stent has slightly covered the large ramus ostea. This is the covering of ramus ostea or snowplow effect. I thought that I should fix, at least balloon dilate the ramus as well as LAD in a V shape, simultaneous kissing balloon. So I passed the wire into the large ramus, but at this point I was not able to take my balloon into the ramus. And when I thought I'll pull the wire and reposition into the ramus, I couldn't do that, and the wire got broken. With the same balloon, I inflated the balloon into the catheter and tried to pull that segment, but I could not. And ultimately, this was what I was left with, a large wire fragment which is there. So this is just a normal wire and the broken wire kept side by side to show what was left inside the coronary. On the circumflex wire, on the ramus wire, I took a snare, but I was not able to catch hold of that wire fragment. So this you can see a large wire fragment from the left main ostea to hanging into the aorta. I tried few crazy loops because in the coronary I was not able to hold the wire, so I tried some crazy loops for the aortic side, but I was nowhere close to the wire. From radial, I shifted to the femoral route. And then once I gave up, I thought that at least I should fix the coronary first, and whatever has happened to the wire, I'll leave it, and I'll discuss with the surgeon whether there is any need to retrieve the wire or not. Because there are case reports where people have reported sudden death with such placed displaced wire fragments, while others say that in a large flowing area like left main and aorta, you can leave such wire fragments. So, So when a balloon was taken into the ramus, there was some movement of the wire fragment. That suggested that if next time I try, I probably might be able to snare it out. So I did a simultaneous kissing balloon. And this was the result after simultaneous kissing balloon, but now the wire fragment has moved, that dot has moved a bit. So again tried snaring, and this time I was lucky. But once I snared out, look, there is no stent, only calcium you can see. So this is what I snared out, wire fragment as well as the implanted stent. But this is a lateral caudal view. You can clearly see the trifurcation, and now the ramus is crystal clean. So there was no snowplow effect. It was a stent which was covering the ramus. It was my carelessness not to take the appropriate view while implanting the stent. So thereafter, the job was simple. Just took the stent in appropriate view. That's a lateral caudal view where the left main trifurcation is clearly seen, and the end result was simple. Thank you.
I think it was a great case. It had many lessons to be learned. First of all, I think I will not call it carelessness, but probably overestimation of your skills, because you said it's a simple case. Somebody, first of all, LAD is a widowmaker artery. If LAD is occluded, it's a flush occlusion, it's a calcified artery. I think Either you are underestimating the vessel occlusion or you are overestimating your skill, because ostial occlusion of calcified left anterior descending artery, I think it is one of difficult propositions, and you should always be prepared for one, whether you'll miss the ostium or get too much into the left main. Two, in a trifurcating vessel, you should all, because you have adjoining two lumens, you should always be thinking, guessing, or maybe sometimes trying to preempt whether something is going to come in front of ramus and possibly going to cause an impingement or compromise. Thirdly, once you break a wire and you are not able to retrieve high up in aorta, I think the simplest thing is have the biggest possible snare. Aorta is around 4 centimeters, so have a biggest possible snare which can be all around aorta, and use a catheter which is angled so that you can turn it any direction, anything will be caught. And what Dr. Kathuria showed, if you have an end snare which has multiple loops, that it's like a blind catch. You go there, open your end snare and close it, it will be caught. Fourthly, once you did that so-called kissing balloon, you have to realize that your wire had traveled through the stent into the ramus. And once you start doing kissing, that means you are changing the anatomy. If you are changing the anatomy, means you are expanding the stent beyond the entry point of your vias into the ramus. Now you should be ready that if you are trying to pull the wire, your stent, if you look at it, was definitely under-deployed. And that under-deployed stent, if it is now kinked through which the wire is going, you should be ready that if you pull it out, this will come out. And lastly, is all mentioned, that if you want to look at the ostium of LAD, in some of the anatomy, especially if the LAD is going up, lateral with shallow caudal is a view of choice. And how you can best test is that you inflate a balloon, keeping the marker at the LAD ostium, and now you test inject. If you inflate a balloon and you test inject, if you find there is a marked compromise of ramus and circumflex or circumflex, that means you are too much into the left main. So that's how you can change the angle and position. So you can test occlude the LAD ostium with the balloon, and then you can position your stent.
Thank you, sir. I'll take care of these points.
Dr. Rajput.
Thank you.
Any comment, any suggestions from the house?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, through the LAD stent. Now, may I invite Dr. Saurabh Bagga? He'll be presenting a case on behalf of Dr. Manish Gunjan. Dr. Saurabh Bagga he had worked with us as a pool officer. He's a very hardworking, very intelligent, budding intervention cardiologist. Let's see what he has to show to us.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Rajesh Kapoor, to give a platform to share my nightmare. This is a 48-year-old female patient, diabetic since 2 years, on OHA, aorta angina since 15 days. Patient was undergone TMT, which was positive. Heart rate was 78, BP 140/T, blood reports normal, EF 60, and patient was taken for CAG for right radial root. This is her angiogram. I will like to say everyone to have a careful eyes on the angiogram. This is the left system, and this is the right system. Any comment in house?
Well, if we look at female, young, and markedly tortuous arteries,
yeah.
Well, this is a good substrate. That means it is like touch me not. If you touch me, you're going to have it. And out of the touch, left touch is often forgiving because left main is bigger in size compared to the catheters. Right touch is not always very forgiving. And getting a good flow in the LAO, which is the first shoot most of the time in left coronary, doesn't give you a guarantee that nothing will happen. Many times you've taken a shoot in the left coronary, in the right coronary, in the LAO view, and now as you're shifting to right coronary, to the RAO view, you might get into trouble. Sometimes the vessel goes into spasm, or at times your diagnostic catheter can create a trouble. I'm not very sure about the ostium in this case.
So let's see what touch has done. This is patient was stable. We have not found anything and shifted back to CCU. The ECG was done. That was normal. Patient was mobilized for washrooms and patient was quite comfortable. After half an hour, she started arguing, complaining of chest pain. The ECG repeated, which show ST elevation V124, echo, LAD territory hypokinetic, VF down to 35. Patient again shifted immediately to cath lab and the shoot was taken with GL guide from the femoral root.
Now, first of all, if I were doing this case, I will suspect, because ST elevation is always telling you. ST depression may not tell you as to where is the problem. But if you have ST elevation, I think there's a reasonable certainty that you're dealing with the anterior part of the left ventricle. And that means it is supplied by the left anterior descending artery. And if you are suspecting left anterior descending artery, then I will load my guiding catheter with a wire, first of all. First wire, I will try to park in the aortic root so that I'm not jumping into the ostium. Second wire, I'll keep just near the tip of the left main. And I'm going to have a very, very gentle injection. Because at times, if you do a good bold injection, then the problem which took place, and we know that these are the vessels which are touch me not kind, if you give a good bold injection, it is possible that you lose everything with the first injection. So I'll just give a gentle injection, and if I have any suspicion, then the second wire which is trying to stop me at the aorta, which is parked hanging in the aorta, that will prevent the guiding catheter from getting into the left main. The other wire which is there at the guiding catheter tip, I will try to, and that should be very slip soft wire and flexible wire, that I'll try to slip most likely in this situation with V1 to V4 elevation towards LAD. Please.
Yeah. The patient started complaining of chest pain, which was increasing. Now what to do? But patient was hemodynamically stable, but the rhythms were getting unstable. So whether to.
So I think there are no options.
No options. So
first option is.
So we attempted for PCI. And what would be next? Either any mechanical circulatory support, go for IABP, ECMO, or other opinion. Since patient is not giving any time, so we. One of the person starting preparation for the IABP, and the other team members are proceeded for the procedure. Whether to 6F or 7F pre-planned in such patient, whether to stand backward or forward. So we had, in emergency, we got the 6 French guide, so we have taken the 6 French guide. Now to decide to stand backward or forward, which wire should we choose? Either the hydrophilic one or hydrophobic one. As we previously see, the anatomy is very tortuous. So either to be hydrophilic or hydrophobic, but the hydrophilic known to extend the dissection. So first we selected BMW wire. We immediately parked the wire, and without thinking anything, we just implanted a stent, 3.5 by 22 onyx. The LED flow is little bit slow. The wire was in some branch. So we again pulled the wire and taken the shot. There is still dissection after the stent. The flow is limiting, not the TME3 flow. So we decided to address the distal LED after the stent. Before that, we have also seen in previous shot there is a LCX was dissecting. So we had the LCX stent with the LCX and the LED wire properly. Taken the shoot, then we implanted a second stent 3.5 by 18 overlapping to the proximal LM to LED stent, and the LED flow was quite good, TME3, but still confusing of the dissection in after the stent. We post dilated the LMCA stent with 4 by 8 to prevent any dissection to be progress after the putting the stent to circ or distal LED. Again, we have taken the shoot. There is a confusion about the distal LED, but we have taken with different views. It's likely to be a branch which is overlapping. Now we can, we have stored the fluorine already. We came for the circ. The dissection in the proximal circ is still there. We pre-dilated with 2x18, the stent struts. There is still a dissection, so we have to address the LCX osteoproximal part. We just taken a 3x15 small stent and inflated just by a tap procedure. The flow in the distal LCX was good. There's still some part of blood is the hematoma in at the POC. So we dilated the LM to LED straight part, stent part. We tried to for casing volume the stent, but we are not sure that the balloon was gone very easily, but we are not sure that the balloon was in right position. We had some confusion, so we have taken the shot, and the balloon was out in the dissection plane. So we retrieved the LCX balloon and wire. Again, taken the shot. We shown that the hematoma is not progressing, but there is still hematoma in distal LCX. So we again dilated the LM to LED stent. By 4x8 balloon at 16 ATM, he put a wire. Seen the LCX, there is still hematoma after the stent and near the crux. So what to do next? Either to stent distally the LCX after the stent or wait, but the hematoma is still there. So we thought to put a wire and dilate the crux. The LCX stent, so the hematoma should, the entry point should be sealed out. And after the balloon, the flow was TME3, the part of the crux is still better, but there is little bit hematoma distal to LCX, but we left at the same position and taken the shoot after the 15 minutes, the position was the same. So we left the patient at the stage. Check CAG was done after 2 days, and this was the result. The distal part is also gets cleaned. Is a no progressive. Patient is stable, doing well. So, the literature reviewed that catheter induced LM dissection with diagnostic data says around 0.8 to 0.2%, and from PCI there is a 0.6 to 0.075%. Osteal LM dissection is rare than the RCA dissection. The various risk factors for dissections are LMCA disease, unusual LMCA anatomy, amplatz use, or small Judkins resulting in deep intubation. As sir was saying that in previous case, the Judkins was get deep inside the mid RCA part. It's not just catheter is freezing moving within the proximal part, so it can't do the dissection. At some stage, it will get stuck after the crossing some part of the artery and create a dissection. Acute MI, extensive catheter manipulation, and again the vigorous contrast injection, which leads to the progression of dissection. The stiffer and less manageable guide wires, deep management of guiding catheter with balloon withdrawn, and the operator experience. So you have to learn from these cases that guiding catheter can be dangerous, especially if not coaxially engaged. Urgent re-escalation is mandated, put the wire and immediately seal the entry point. Do not think anything before doing. The retrograde dissection involving coronary cusp, which was is not our case, but if there is a retrograde extension of the dissection of the aortic wall till the less than 14 mm, then should we can continue with the conservative treatment. If more than 14 mm, we have to think for the repair for that. PCI is the life-saving procedure for acute LMC dissection. Complete seal of the entry site as well as the LMC origin is important to prevent the further extension of dissection. And always call for help. Thank you.
I think it was a great case. It can happen to anyone. And I think you manage it in best possible way. Just one comment. If one had the luxury of floating in an IVOS catheter, maybe you would have got the distal extent of the dissection, and if you really know the distal extent of the dissection, then it is preferable to start stenting from distal. If you stent from distal, that means you do not let any hematoma go distally. So if you start stenting distally, then as you start putting the stent proximally, the hematoma is expressed out into the intravascular lumen. Because if you start stenting proximally, you have trapped the flap and hematoma, and further stenting in that coronary tree into circumflex or into LAD will do what? It will do only one thing. It will squeeze the hematoma distally. And you will always be very unhappy at the distal end of any new stent which you put, as was happening in this patient. We were unhappy distal to the second LAD stent. We were unhappy distal to the circumflex also. We tried to do, but I think one should not be chasing the lumens. If the flow is good, I think you just stop there. Because these hematomas, if the flow is good, will get absorbed over a period of time. Dr. Rajput.
I think a very well managed case. And I think in these situations, it is very necessary not to lose cool and do whatever technique you are. There could be a lot of debates about which technique, how to stent, circ first, LAD first, which technique, whatever you are comfortable with. And I think now this is a bit of a change. If it's a very long dissection, then there could be debate where you start proximally or distally. But generally, it is a conventional teaching that if you seal the proximal end, the distal end would close itself.
I want to ask just one thing.
But if you trap a hematoma, as happened in this case, then you keep extending the hematoma with every further stent. So that's what I'm saying, that if you had the luxury of having, and I was with you, and if you pass in an IVUS catheter, and you know that dissection is extending till this part, then without giving any coronary shot, because any coronary shot means further extension of the hematoma. So just keeping the pleural landmark, go distal to the site which is told by echo, by intravascular ultrasound, that this is still where the dissection is there. Go distal to that, put first single stent. After that, you can put a single long stent or whatever things.
I want to just discuss one question with the house, that routinely we use different bifurcation techniques. What should be in such a dissection case the bifurcation part should be? It's what you tap or it is crush or coulette? Because the wire and balloon was going towards from the dissection plane. So whether to cover, go for coulette or whether to go for tap only?
See, this is a situation where there is hardly any atheroma. And if there is hardly any atheroma, then at least I don't see any point in making any carina. So you should be, even if you leave a millimeter or two of the ostium of circumflex with a stent proximal and distal, the flap cannot get down and close the lumen. So I will not resort to the standard so-called techniques of bifurcation. I'll try to stay away from carina, don't make any big carina, don't indulge into crushing in the roll. And I may just be very, very happy with a bare metal stent in this situation, because I will not like to use a drug-eluting stent, because this is, you do not need anything as far as restenosis is concerned. You just need a scaffold. And bare metal stent may be a good option in this situation.
Both of you. Now only two things. You know, it's done with a radial and deeply throttled diagnostic GL. So I think while, especially in radials, it's a lot of movement. You know, at times there is no wedging, but it may touch the wall while you start giving injection. So one has to be very gentle if it is deep. So, but there was no clue. I think there was no clue until you were doing the angiography. It was fine on the left side and it was just taken as a shock. Second, the dissection was visible in the LAD beyond that point. So IVUS or something else is different, but if it is visible, then cover it. I think that's the point. I also agree with Dr. Trehan on that.
Dr. Trehan, can I make a point? You know, when you are doing a radial procedure, many a times you do it with the same catheter. So you hook the left, and then once the left shots are taken, you rotate the catheter. If you don't take out the catheter from the left main, and then anti-clockwise torque and put it in the right coronary sinus and then hook the right coronary, you're likely to dissect the left main and go into the right coronary. Maybe this is the case that happened in your case. Because I don't see your catheter getting wedged into the left system. It was a very good shot. What happened was possibly you rotated, the operator rotated when it was in the left main, you rotate and you scrape the left main and go to the right.
Maybe I agree with you.
Saurav, can you show your first shoot?
Because the
first shoot of the dissected vessel.
Because the dissection plane was on the lower side of LMCA.
No, can you just show the first shoot?
It happened from the mid left main.
So because the at least angiogram doesn't show you that the problem has taken place at the isostium. So no. That explanation is true if you start injuring the ostium. But if you look at it, I think the ostium, at least angiographically, doesn't need to be look to be terribly bad. I think the problem is a couple of millimeters after the ostium.
Mid left. Main.
Yeah.
But it could be just the end of the last injection where it is not visible, but it created nidus.
There's no deep.
No. Next.
But in the helicoidal view, you will see that the tip was quite deep.
See, it's quite deep. So usually it doesn't happen. It's a normal left main, but then with the radial, I think with changing movement all the time, it's an injection force and everything counts. So if just it punctured the endothelium somewhere and just created the nidus.
Yeah, certainly the thing happened because of the procedure, there's no doubt. But I think the things were not catastrophic at the point when you were doing the procedure. And in fact, they were even missed during the angiogram. And if you create an injury, it is possible that over a period of time with each systolic pressure that dissection spreads and half an hour later you get this problem. So I see nothing wrong as far as procedure is concerned. So that's what I'm saying, that anybody out of us can be in trouble. And they have managed this case problem. In fact, I was, if you ask me, I'm slightly doubtful about the right coronary ostium. Because the moment you said ST elevation in V1 to V4, I changed my stance. Because ST elevation typically tells you, and I tried to look at the whether this PD is very long or not. This PD is also not very long, so you can't have a V1 to V4 elevation because I am as RCA. Thank you, Dr. Saurav.
Thank you.
Very good case. I think give him a big hand. Very nicely managed. Invite.
Now, the next case is going to be presented by Dr. Pankaj Batra and Dr. Sanjay Kumar.
The case of Pankaj, since he's not here, I'm presenting it. This is a patient who had a recent anterior wall MI and had recurrent post-MI angina. He presented to us with this angiogram, a critical lesion in the circumflex, OM, and a long lesion in the LAD. As this was a long lesion, he wired, the artery was wired and subsequently was planned to be covered with one long stent. As we know, MOF is available in 60 millimeters. And he did manage to send the stent down with a bit of difficulty. Standing down MOF stents are pretty rigid stents. With a bit of pushing, did get there and inflated it. Thereafter, you can see the flow there. The wire is in a small side branch, but reasonably that area has been covered. Subsequently, he was post-dilating it. While post-dilating the stent, we see a perf. Looks like a localized grade 1 perf, but nevertheless, LAD patient getting unstable. Or maybe grade 2 because I can see a bit of myocardial staining also there. Was covered with a covered stent. And yes, the patient did require tamponade drainage immediately after that. It was basically oversized balloon dilatation that probably led to the perf. Long stent, and when you push in long stents, it tends to get deformed, maybe a bit of wire, the stent getting deformed, injuring the artery, and then when you dilate with a larger balloon, probably it causes a localized perforation. That's what.
Which cover stent was?
So the Abbott one.
Because this is a rarity now to have these cover stents on shelves.
Sir, now
and,
it's
and the one from Abbott is a little bulky device. It's not very easy to deliver, especially if the perforation is in the distal part of a very long stent. Morph is a very long stent. So I think you've done it very well, because.
What to do if there is no cover stent on the shelf?
Prolonged inflation of the balloon
may or may not help.
And it's a problem. I think currently the covered stents are not readily available. It is.
In one case, you know, we took a balloon, 20 millimeter balloon, and then 18 stent. And that balloon was cut from both the sides, and the wrap was taken out. The balloon envelope was taken out and then wrapped over the stent. And then went ahead. Only thing is, it has to be a clear passage, because that's not tightly crimped over the stent. So that this type of covered stent one can make in the cath lab if it is not available. So
come again. I did not take.
So take a balloon, new balloon. Mm-hmm. Cut the ends. So then the envelope of the balloon you can take it out.
Okay.
Right, as such, and then that balloon can be wrapped over the stent, new stent, you know. So it's a 2 millimeter balloon or 2.5 balloon, depending on this thing, your vessel size. And then now only thing is, it's loosely wrapped around. It's not very tight. So then you can just advance that thing.
It has to be smooth.
There should not be any resistance, because that may get detached.
Actually, I had published this technique about 10 years ago. There are two methods. One method is to take a bare balloon on the stent, in which case you will have to stitch the balloon onto the stent, usually with something like 5-0 proline. And this is a technique which we used to do some 25 years ago, take out a cephalic vein and put it on the stent, make it a covered stent, and then deliver it. But nowadays what we do is, you have a bare stent which is on a balloon, let's say whatever size, let's say it's a 3x15 millimeter stent. So you take 3x15 millimeter balloon. Now what you do is, you cut the balloon with the help of a scissors at the ends of the balloon. Now the moment you cut it, the whole hole of the balloon will be taken out. Now you, please listen. Now you will put it on the stent. If you put it on the stent, you can't move it in the artery. Now what you do is, you put one more stent on it, onto it. So single balloon, cut balloon on the stent will not go. You take out a shave balloon off the shaft, put it on a stent. Now you put one more stent over it and then crimp it. This becomes a very bulky device. And if you have to now deliver it, ensure that you have a guide liner distal to the lesion. Because just in case you are not able to deliver, you can pull out the whole assembly. So if you have to make this kind of a covered stent in the cath lab itself, have same size balloon, have same size stent which you can take off the stent balloon, which is usually inflated with a 1.5 or 2 millimeter balloon, and then you can put that stent on the first stent with a balloon around it. So it is a pretty tricky affair, and I will say that maybe you indulge into it only if you have a lot of experience, which you have done much before getting into a catastrophe. Because in catastrophe, if you are trying to handle this kind of a problem with this kind of a self-manufactured balloon, often you will get into some kind of a problem. So it is much better to just, because this was an infarct-related artery, sometime these vessels, they will tolerate balloon occlusion for much longer time than if a vessel was not infarct-related. At times, if you go down with an anticoagulation or you reverse your anticoagulation, because after femoral holes also, if you press them, they will heal. So all what is required is that if, as you are trying to seal that vessel, do a balloon tamponade, your patient should be able to tolerate that. Please.
And this looked like not a free-flowing perforation, so as a routine procedure, the balloon inflation should be tried. It might still work. So
I think the line of demarcation is pretty thin, because if it was not free-flowing, she developed tamponade. We had to drain.
Yeah, that's we agree with you that it's very difficult to really know as to in which case you will put it. You have to keep all the options open. But in this case, since it was an infarcted artery, maybe the patient would have given you more time to inflate the balloon there, because many times balloon inflation in such patients, they give you time. But if it is a non-infarcted artery, then you inflate a balloon, a couple of minutes down the line, your ST segment will start changing, your patient will become uncomfortable, your hemodynamics will compromise. So, again, it's a very, very tricky affair. And we have absolutely nothing to say, because we have done it, we have tested both, continued bleed, and we have also tested thrombus.
I
don't think I'll be able to really give you any kind of a good guide.
I think neutralizing heparin should be done only once the whole assembly is out. Otherwise, don't do it till the balloon is in the artery, because you'll have thrombus formation.
No. I don't agree. See,
just gave 1 cc of protamine.
So what I usually do is I start reversing it partly, and keep the balloon there and deflate it in between and keep counter checking it. I've had many instances where we have used this technique of partially reversing and keeping a balloon inflated for maybe 5-10 minutes and then deflating a balloon and then checking. And of course, once you're fully reversed, and then if you have assembly inside, then you are inviting a thrombus. But you do not necessarily need to fully reverse. A part reversal of heparin and in between deflating a balloon often gives you enough continuous flow, which prevents a thrombus formation within the lumen, but helps you in forming a thrombus outside. But at the same time, I can't really give you a perfect method.
But
so it is just a question of trying.
If you have a thrombus then, in the proximal
vessel? If you have a covered stent on shelf, and if you're sure you want to deliver it, then I don't think there is any room for reversing anticoagulation. Then the anticoagulation should be full, because covered stents are thrombogenic. If the environment is prothrombotic, then you never have to do it. But just in case you do not have a covered stent, or sometime you have perforated a vessel which is distal and 2 millimeters, and you're sure that you have a covered graft which is 3 millimeters and cannot go there, I think in those situations you will have to use partial reversal, partial balloon tamponading, and keeping and checking from time to time. And often these patients, if the vessel is distal, they will give you a lot of time to occlude the vessel. And also in infarcted vessel also, you can inflate the balloon for a longer time than it would have been usually.
Does anything happen to the pericardial blood?
Pericardial? If you have reversed anticoagulation, then it is a very, very difficult preposition to take out the blood from the pericardial sac. Because if you have reversed it, and what you get is a blood which has gone in the pericardial sac and that has formed big clots, it may be very, very difficult to take out. So, and on the contrary, if the blood is not coagulated, then it's very easy to take out that blood. So, from pericardial aspiration point of view, it is better not to reverse the anticoagulation. The second thing which I will say is that if you have entered the pericardial sac, then you should feel very, very bold. You take the sheath of the biggest size. You have a 14-French sheath, put a 14-French sheath in the pericardial sac. Don't hesitate, because a 14-French sheath will permit you to even suck the clots. Whereas a 6 or a 7-French, if you put a 6-French sheath, you put a 6-French pigtail, it all has very small holes, then the clots cannot be sucked. So what you can do is you can put the biggest possible sheath in the pericardial sac. After all, surgeons also in size and create big holes. Put the biggest possible sheath, and you can slide in a smaller catheter. Now, if a smaller catheter is around, then it will help you in some time aspirating a clot. So that's you're talking about a ping pong technique. So that I think it is. That is a very important technique also.
In this case, actually, you know, what happened?
Patient was relatively stable.
Once we noticed the perforation, immediately a covered stent was put. There was very, very minimal pericardial effusion. So at that time, it was not drained. Patient was shifted, patient was stable. But yes, 3-4 hours later, patient had hypotension, tachycardia. That time, patient was in tamponade and had to be drained bedside. So these demarcations, you know, I think even if you look at the angiographic thing, the thing had closed, but probably it does leak, and as we know, small amount of blood accumulation does cause tamponade acutely. But this happened, the tamponade was actually obvious after 2 hours.
Actually, if you have a stent graft, then you do not reverse heparin.
Yeah.
But if you do not have a stent graft, and then occlude it only with a balloon, then I think again it's a wishful thinking. If your internal environment is fully anticoagulated, just putting a balloon there for 10 or 15 minutes, it will never stop. It will keep bleeding. So if you do not have a stent graft and you want to possibly close it with the help of a balloon, you will have to do some kind of a reversal. It may not be full reversal. Which I do is I often do it. Partial reversal and keep checking, frequently keep checking angiographically and frequently keep checking this ACT. If it is in the left system, then I'm very, very scared. If it is in the right system, then of course, all what you have to lose, you'll be losing only right. But in left, if in just in case you form a thrombus in one of the vessels which traverses upward towards the left main, then it's a big catastrophe. So in the left, we are more careful. We try and close it with the help of a stent graft, keep the anticoagulation on. So thank you very much. I think it was again a great case. Now the nobody. So, I think there is one last case. Dr. Deepak is there. He's come all the way from Amritsar. Yeah.
I think that is the technique to be used when there is a decision to try tamponade for some time. Stent graft is an issue, and then there is an issue when you deflate it for a longer time. There will be again recollection. So you paste another guide, put another wire, so that the inflation deflation is quick.
No. It's not like this. If you have created a grade 3 perforation, and your patient has gone into tamponade in seconds, it's not like you inflate balloon and check, no. If it's a grade 3 perforation, your patient has gone into tamponade, the first thing is you inflate the balloon there only. Take an excess from the other side, and be ready for the ping pong technique.
Minutes of yours, basically a 70 years female, had come with 2-3 days history of chest pain and with bradycardia blocks, put on a TPI and taken up for angiogram, the right coronary, it was a co-dominant coronary and which showed almost 99% occlusion, and that's what we plan to stent. And took a JR guiding, pre-dilated, it was all, took a hydrophilic wire because there was some curve in the RCA. And ballooned it, and then took a 2.532 stent, and tried to inflate the stent. And just look at this scene, and this is where the problem started. The balloon just wouldn't inflate in the center. We could see some inflation of the balloon at the edges, but at the center, the balloon refused to inflate. And as we increased the pressure,
What was the stent? Because we have to know which stent it was, because there is some problem in the manufacturing. The balloon has the balloon is ruptured, so balloon is not able to go up. So if the balloon doesn't go up, the stent will not inflate.
It's a very good indigenous stent. It's an Indian stent and does very well, I guess, in all the labs. One of the most frequently used stents. And then it just wouldn't go up. And as we increased the pressure on the deflator, the balloon ruptured and we had no flow in the vessel. Again, ST elevation, patient had pain, and you can see this rupture of the balloon here. Now, when I try to remove the balloon, it gets stuck in the middle of the stent because that part is not inflated, and now nothing is coming out. The balloon, the stent, it gets crumpled in the proximal part of the artery, and it's just stuck there with no flow. Patient has pain, and you can see here, there is a crumpled part of the stent in the proximal part of the vessel. Now, what to do here? We were pretty much stuck up, and patient having a recurrence of pain and hypotension. just as I try to pull more, there is more crumpling of the stent there, but the balloon wouldn't budge. So what we did, we punctured the same artery, took another guiding there, and then wired the this vessel from the other guiding, and try to pass the wire through the side of the stent, and took in a 2O New York balloon, and inflated it at just 2 atmosphere pressure, and now when we try to pull the stent balloon, we could take it out. So once we had taken out the stent balloon, then we could dilate we tried to crush the stent there in the middle part, but the balloon wouldn't go into the distal part of the stent because the wire distally passing through the struts of the stent, which was pretty much visible in the RAO view, that the distal part of the wire is passing through the struts of the stent, so no balloon would go there. Now with even this is a 1.25 balloon which wouldn't go distally, so with multiple attempts we could pass a wire in the RAO view by the side of the crumpled stent, and then we could take a balloon, crush it with a 2 millimeter balloon, and put another stent, inflated it, post dilated it, and I guess got a reasonable result, and thank God the patient went home. Thank you.
So now will you be happy in telling us this stent? Now that patient is happy, gone home, and everything is fine.
I think would be very, you know, susceptible using this stents, and I think it's already off the shelf of our lab, and the company.
No,
is
so that others are also careful, because this will be certainly very, very unpleasant situation for any of the interventionists to have a long stent in, and the balloon dhoka da ja aapko halfway through.
I think problem with the hardware, but it has happened a couple of times and with different stents.
Same stent, different stent.
Yeah, different stents. Yeah.
And what was the different stent?
They all been Indian stents. And I think we can discuss over dinner. Sure. Thank you.
Only differently, you know, which I think. So did you try to pull it as a unit with not the guiding there, with the guiding back?
Everything. No. But if I had removed the wire, I would have been in more trouble.
No,
actually.
Not the wire.
I tried as an assembly to pull it. It just kept on getting more crumpled there.
No, crumpled there because guiding was there. It was hitting the guiding and getting crumpled. If you take the guiding into aorta and try to pull as an assembly, was it coming back?
I think used enough force, nothing was coming out.
It is unlikely. But if you want a tip, I can give you a tip. Because we've handled many of such situations.
Yeah.
There was a time when we had, in my hospital, the so-called FDA-approved stents were not available, and for a year we were left with some of the local stents. And 6 months, we embolized 27 stents, 27, and all were taken out. And I would have done it differently. I'll tell you a very simple trick. See, the moment you find your balloon is ruptured, and now what is it? See, this artery is otherwise flowing. This artery stopped to flow because halfway your stent has inflated half. So it is still not fully expanded. So it is, and the vessel is also not very large in size. But fortunately, since it is a co-dominant situation, it's not a very large artery, so not a large ischemic burden. What I would have done was, you have the stent shaft which is coming out, just break it at the hub end. Okay. You take a snare, advance a snare over the wire and over this balloon, take it, because proximal end of the stent is right close to your guiding. Take it there, open your snare, snare will go over the stent, catch it, and now pull out the assembly as a whole. And then you should be ready to do the task either from the same puncture or the other puncture. This is a much better technique than trying to pull the assembly as a whole. Because if you're trying to pull the assembly as a whole, the commonest problem is your stent will come out from the distalmost right coronary. Now part will be within the aorta and part is still in the right coronary artery. This is a time when ab dhoka de jayega. Now if you pull, what will happen is your guiding and wire will come out and the stent will be hanging in the aorta, which is a much difficult proposition. See, it is a simpler proposition once your stent is on the balloon, break the hub end of the balloon, advance a snare, small snare, 4 millimeter snare over it, and take it to the ostium of the right coronary artery, open the snare, catch the stent and pull out the assembly. And once they are pulled out, then I think the task will be easy.
You want to catch the distal edge of the stent or the proximal edge of the stent?
What?
You want to catch the proximal edge of the stent?
Proximal. You can never go to the distal.
No. I will try to catch it as distal as possible. If I have caught the proximal again, I mean, so I will try to pass the snare as distal as possible. If it is catching only the proximal end and is not going distally, I'll still be happy. But if I am given an option, I will try to take it as distal, because if I am going at distal, then my grip is much better.
I think if we are able to crush the stent, that is probably the safest proposition. Less crushing? Trauma to the, yeah, if you can crush with the ball.
I find that crushing is a useless method, and just try to crush it in a tube and see. It's a very, very useless option. In case, let's say, nothing is there, then in such a situation, because proximal part of the balloon has inflated a little bit, distal part of the balloon has also inflated a little bit.
Dumbbell kind of, yeah.
It is only the middle part of the balloon which is not inflated. If you are very careful, you can always pass a wire through the center of this balloon. Okay. And then you can take another balloon and try to inflate. Smallest balloon, maybe sub-millimeter balloon. Nowadays, you have a balloon which is less than 1 millimeter also.
Yeah.
CTO balloons, they can be used to burrow into this lesion and gradually you can inflate. But it's a difficult proposition.
Dr. Trihan, modifying what you say, we break the hub of the stent.
Yeah.
And then put a microcatheter on it.
No microcatheter.
And then pull with the microcatheter.
No. You take a snare with its snare catheter.
A snare can damage the wall of the artery because it's going to catch it like that and bring it up, isn't it?
Wall of what?
Wall of the artery.
Vessel.
Vessel, yeah.
Well, there is
because
a small...
You're cutting in the middle and
there,
then pulling
there is a small possibility, but if you look at this, I think this stent has not... It has gone, I think, till about 1.5 millimeter in diameter. The vessel is still about 2+.
Distal is well expanded.
But at the same time, the stent has never gone, expanded, and opposed the vessel wall. It's still loose. So if you catch the stent from the proximal end, it is likely to do a little bit of damage, but I don't think terrible damage is expected in this relatively straighter artery. And the stent still smaller in profile. If you catch it from the proximal end, I usually don't see anything greatly wrong happening. And in fact, I will not even put a second guiding. I will just try to take it out because I'll be reasonably sure that once it is out, then I should be able to wire it.
In fact, we had some wire-induced stenting at the distal end of RCA.
Yeah.
And luckily, it just passed off.
Yeah, those things, because once you're muscling around, muscle around in the vessel, you are likely to have those jakhma reh jate hain wahan par thode bahut distally. Yeah.
Thank you.
So, I think you give him a big hand because he showed us two cases, but he cleverly refused to divulge the name of the stent. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Thanks, Dr. Trihan. Thanks, Dr. Rajput. It was fantastic having you, and you made it quite more exciting, this session. So I think this was all for our side here today. But excitement still continues. We are on with some musical program, which I think the guys would be making the stage ready in next 20 minutes, and then they start it. So before I really finish, I think thanks to all of you who have really come all the way on this Sunday and be here with us. Thanks to those who have come out of station and others who have come from Delhi NCR, but still on Sunday they are sitting all the way throughout the day here. So thank you very much. Thanks to my team, we were able to do so because despite the heavy cath lab timings, we usually finish at 9:30, 10 p.m. Dr. Himanshu, Dr. Dhirinder, Dr. Simmer, all are here. So they could do many of our cases, so I could find time. That's the reason we were shuttling and making this program. It was almost a month of hard work. Thanks to the guys who have come forward and sponsored this event, and our office staff, Sakshi, Sohan, and Sandeep. So they have done quite a hard work. So thanks to all of you. So this is all, and hope this was exciting and stimulating for all of you. We had different sessions. We starting with some pharmaceutical newer agents, SGLT2 inhibitors or other things in the morning. Then the valvular intervention session was exciting according to me. And this, obviously, this session was also good, and some real life cases. So I think that real learning lies there with real life cases. So that's our endeavor, to involve more and more real life cases here. Thank you very much once again from my heart.